some lean stuff. Literally just walked in the door and got coffee. We met once, yeah.
Ahmed Saber.
Okay, probably last met like a year and a half ago.
Yeah, yeah.
Whenever you were doing your proposal, right? One is a different size from the other two, so mm-hmm. It's kind of a... What can you do? If I had one for every day of the week, I would be set.
That's right.
Actually, I have four now, right?
You almost do.
Problem is, unless you wear it every single day, people think you're wearing the same shirt.
Right.
I think if you wore it every day, the same uniform, people would say, well, it's a uniform, like UPS
yeah.
or... So is summer session B already underway? Is that what we're seeing today? No. A lot of students in the building. You seem like a new energy. I had the first day of school feel it was, but now you know that people wandering around, kind of like new faces. It's amazing.
Trying to find their room and stuff.
Yeah. That they would kick that off like right before the 4th of July. Like they're going to get in today and then tomorrow's off.
Mondays off.
Unless sometimes they do weird things like have school on Friday.
Stitches.
Twilight Pediatrics.
Yeah.
Have you ever been there?
One once, yeah.
Dr. Q is pretty good.
Yeah, you told me that you used to.
It's definitely a better deal than the emergency room, I would say.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
I think these guys won't charge you as much.
Yeah, about half, I think.
Then again, I think it's like $175 until you run up to your deductible limit or whatever. So maybe it isn't that much.
Well, ours was. I think you and I have the opposing insurance plans.
Oh, is that right?
I have kids that get sick and do dumb things, so I have to pay a lot in premiums now, and not much in terms of office visits.
I haven't looked at the variations and plans in so long.
Yeah.
Morning.
Hey,
morning.
Talking about that.
Hey, good morning.
You know, Ahmed, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It may have been a while, but... Cut that shin a year ago, and I think he reopened it.
Uh-huh.
I mean,
But if you have stitches?
He's good to go. He wasn't under my.
No, but a year ago.
He had the glue.
Yeah.
Glue.
And the glue was a mistake.
Mine.
The glue kind of comes out. And
so
mine had 5 stitches here.
Yeah? Like real stitches?
Real stitches.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Like 3 months ago.
Oh, wow.
And they asked, I mean, it was too deep for a glue, so they had to put the stitches. And since then, we have been applying some kind of, what's the name?
Trying to get the scar to kind of.
Mm-hmm. And now it's just disappearing.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it's, I don't remember the name of it. It's kind of a gel.
Myderma?
Something like that. It's great. Wow, in 3 months it's suddenly disappearing.
Huh.
Mm-hmm.
Try for the next wound.
That's right.
Yeah.
Or you just say, scars are cool, kid.
That's true. The stitches
are better than the
deal. Can I just mention something? I'm broadcasting the presentation on Facebook Live, so just to let you know. That's a clue you.
Oh, we're in Facebook right now?
Yeah, so if you don't want to, I can just disable it.
Oh, it's on now?
Yeah.
Okay, just the audio?
It's video, but it's video showing only the presentation. It's right there, the phone.
Okay. Again, I'll say I have no objection to your presentation only being on the Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know you'd already started, or else we would have had some chit chat.
Yes.
If the rest of the committee's okay with that, the presentation alone can be broadcast, and then we'll shut it down for the question and answer period.
Yes, for the questions. And
that's good.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's okay.
Everybody okay with that? So obviously we're all here today for the thesis defense of Ahmed Saber, who's going to defend his thesis on vision-aided navigation for autonomous vehicles using tracked feature points. Standard format for today will be the usual. Ahmed will give a presentation about his work. I would say if there are any questions during the presentation, we'll go ahead and ask them. If they're just for clarifications of things on the slides or just to, small questions, and then we can save maybe some of the larger scale questions for after the talk. Normally we would open it up for general questions after the talk, but it's pretty much just us, so we'll examine you after your presentation is over with questions from the whole committee. After that, the committee will request some time alone to discuss things, and then we'll call you back in.
Okay.
So with that said, whenever you're ready, on.
Okay, so I'm Ahmed. I think you already know now. So today I'm going to talk about VA in navigation for autonomous vehicle using track feature point. So our agenda today is first some introduction, what I'm trying to solve here, what is the problem, what is the issue I'm trying to solve, and how I'm going to solve it. Then I'll start with some background on feature detection and tracking, and speak a little bit about navigation sensors and algorithms. Then discuss more in detail the algorithm developed for the feature in navigation, sensor fusion. And then discuss the result and implementation of the algorithm and end with the conclusion. So, we'd like to solve a navigation problem. So, the most common sensor used for navigation is the GPS, the global positioning system. However, the GPS has some problems. It doesn't work well in indoors, also doesn't work well in cluttered environment. It's not available all the time because it requires satellites. So some places won't have the satellites, like asteroids or other planets. As for the vision-based navigation, basically using a camera to estimate the both and the position and the rotation of any vehicle. It's available for angle estimation, but has a problem with the translation estimation, which is a skill ambiguity, which we're going to discuss later. The IMU based navigation, using an IMU to estimate the position of the vehicle. However, because it is to estimate the position, you need to integrate this measurement is very noisy, so it's an occasional noisy measurement resulting in drift error over time. So it's not very not reliable after some time. So the objective here is to get in the best of two worlds, which is the vision based and the IMU based, and trying to provide a comparable result to the GPS like output or algorithm. So let's take a little bit about feature tracking. So what is a feature point? Feature point is just include a vision to just a region of interest or a point of interest in an image. And it is considered the building block for most computer algorithms, computer vision algorithms. That's why any algorithm that depends on feature detection has it will be only performed as well as the feature vector itself. Why we are doing feature extraction detection? Because if we're just comparing the whole image, trying to describe the whole image as an image directly, that's a large amount of information. So that's why we're trying to use features to better describe the image in far less variables. And this way, it's going to be less computational power and memory required to process the image or describe the image. Usually, the filtering step is done to smooth the image before doing facial detection or extraction to make it more efficient. So, we have three main type of features, which are edges, corners, and blocks. An edge in an image is representing points with strong gradient. In one direction, which can be commanded from boundaries or lines in an image. A corner doesn't have to be an actual corner in an image, it is just an interest point which has local two-dimensional, it is a local two-dimensional structure, which has gradients in both directions in the image. So it can be just a bright spot on a dark area, it doesn't have to be an actual corner. And the other thing is the blobs, which just a region of the image, not a point like feature that, as the other two. For example, this kind of shapes, like ellipses or just any shapes, we can describe them as a point of interest, which you can use as a feature. So, how we, like which feature we should detect or we should use? For example, if you have this blue block here, that's a batch in the image. If we move this block around, you won't get any new information, so you can't really track it over multiple frames. You don't know which batch you are extracting right now, so that's made this one not very good to use. However, this one, the black batch, is if you move it in the x direction, you still get the same batch, so it's not very useful. But if you move it in the y direction, you will get different batches which make it easier to detect, which you can consider an edge here. And the last batch we can use in an image is the corner, which if we move the red batch in any direction, we get a different batch which will make it easier to detect. So that's why it is considered a better feature to track. If you apply this on a real world image, you have the batch A and B here. It can be anywhere in the image, like part of the sky or part of the side of the building. You can't really tell which part of it. However, for the other two, C and D, you can say that this part of this edge here or part of this edge here, but instead you can't define which part of the image. And for the last type of corners, which last type of feature, which are corners, you only can see them once in the whole image, which this one here and this one here, which make it much easier to track in subsequent frames. So there are some feature tracking detection algorithms. For example, for edge detection, we have Kenny and Sobel operator. We have Harris also can be used for edge detection, and also Harris and Charlie and Task, SIFT, and Surfing. Can I talk more in detail about the corner detection method, because that's more relevant to the navigation problem, because you can't really use the edge detection for navigation. So we're going to discuss a little more about each of these four. So Harris invented minute like difference between with U and V over a window of X and Y. So basically if I so it gives the weight under the pixel under it. So the bigger the difference between the displacement and the actual apparent intensity, the more that means that's a corner or an actual feature. So this way, Harris look for a large E. If it is a large E, that means this area contains a corner or an edge. So if you apply this on an actual image, you, for example, you have the linear edge here. If you take the derivative, you can get a line in the derivative, but you won't get anything in the whether for the flat image, you won't get anything in both derivatives. However, for a corner, you're going to get in both directions a line which will make it defined. And so basically, the Harris tried to use a scoring function for each displacement, for each E, which using the determinant of M, M is the, basically the derivative, the image gradient derivative of the image in both directions, which is 2x2 matrix. So the derivative of x according to x according to y according to x, and y according to y. And using the determinant is basically the diagonal, lambda 1 by lambda 2, and the trace is just lambda 1 by plus lambda 2. And k is just a constant defined between 0.04 and 0.6, which will be used, can be used to tune the vector to see if it's an edge or a corner. So trying to use almost the same approach by Harris, the only difference he made is changing the scoring function. So instead of using the determinant and the trace, they are using the minimum of M, which is basically the minimum of lambda 1 and lambda 2. And this way, the corner will be only this unique area in an image. FAST, which is basically FAST, but it is short for features from from accelerated segment test, which is used in real time, in most real time applications because it's performance. Basically, how it works, it selects a pixel in an image, then select a threshold, and then start to form a circle around this pixel, usually it's a 16 pixel circle, and then start to compare, like to find a contiguous set of n pixels in this circle, which larger than the intensity function of this of B plus the threshold, or darker than the intensity function of B minus the threshold. If any of this found, that means this circle contains a corner or an edge. However, instead of comparing each pixel, usually it is comparing the corners, which is like pixel 1, 3, and 9, and 13, 5, 1, 5, and 9, and 13. And if any of the three, like any three of these four will satisfy the same condition, this consider a corner directly. So that's for the high speed test, instead of comparing everything. That's why it is running fast. For however, for the biggest, like the Harris and the FAST methods, suffer from a main issue, which is the scale. It can predict the corner or the edge if it is rotated or translated in the image, but if it is scale, or maybe the camera came closer or farther away from the image, it can't work because the window function won't be able to predict the corner. For example, it can predict it here, but when the edge, the corner became big like this, the window function won't be able to detect it. So SEP was introduced to solve the scaling issue, which is called a scale invariant feature transform. It's solved it by applying difference of Gaussian estimation for each of the like different scales. Doing multiple scale on the image and doing different Gaussian for each image, plotting the image in different values and taking a difference of it and using this as to predict the features. This way it can assign for each scale, for each feature a scale which can be used to sort of describe the feature in the scale without an issue with the scale. SIFT is good, but it is very slow. That's why SIRF was introduced to use, instead of using different Gaussian, it is using a box filter, which is the SIFT stands for its use of robust features. And so it provides a box filter to solve the scaling problem instead of using different Gaussian, which make it much faster than the SIFT. So after we detect the feature, we do the step of we try to do the step of tracking. But in order to track, we need to do solve a problem called image recognition, which basically trying to extract relevant information from the camera and construct a 3D view or like a structure from motion of the scene using multiple images. So the way it does this, it do it in stages, which is feature detection and matching, then start to transform model estimation between each pair of image, so it can define how the image rotated and moved from the vivid image. After it done this, it do a resampling and transformation of the actual image to be able to track feature over time. After we solve the image restoration, we have some challenges. To get an optimal output from it, we need to choose a good feature to track. As we described before, it has to be invariant for scaling, rotation, and translation. It has to be efficient. Also, we have an issue with the drift, which will be happening because of the small error accumulation when we update the model over track points. Also, the records may disappear or appear or due to occlusion or moving out of the field of view. And the last problem we need to take care of is the outlier rejection, which is required for optimization. Outlier basically is matching the feature point, which not supposed to match, like false positive. So maybe the description wasn't key enough, or maybe due to noise, maybe due to different variables, this will happen. So we need to provide a mechanism to reject the outliers, or be able to detect the outliers and reject them from the track features. So KLT, or I can ask for the Lucas Massey algorithm, is the tracking algorithm used here. It is the most commonly used algorithm method for feature-based implementation. It tried to solve the structure of from motion problem by which recovering the scene geometry from camera motion using sequence of images. And it assumed there is some assumption in the KLT, which is the brightness consistency between each image sequence, and also the small motion, it is like a very small motion between each image pair. However, this can be solved by the multi-scale pyramid implementation. Also, it assumes the spatial coordinates. The main equation that KLT is trying to solve is this equation here. So basically, this information, G is the gradient of the image, W is the window function, and A is the actual image. So basically I can extract this information from one frame. And basically I'm trying to split the distance, which is the distance between each image and the next image. So the left side can be extracted from one frame, the right side can be extracted from the difference of the two frames, which H is basically the difference between I X Y T and I X Y T plus one. So this way we have information from here from two frames, and we have information from one frame, we can experience the description. more details about the sensors, navigation algorithm. I'm using the GPS and IMU and vision. So GPS is just a background about it. It is developed by the US military in 1960. First GPS satellite was launched in 1978. We have 24 satellites surrounding the Earth. Minimum of 3 satellites is required to triangulate the position, because we need 3 spheres intersecting together to get the location of the receiver. Basically, the algorithm is using time of flight, which is coming from the time transmission, which is sent by every satellite, and the time of arrival, which also sent by each satellite. After we get the intersection of the 3 spheres, we can pinpoint the US receiver location. So the problems we have with the GPS, we can get it from multiple sources. One of them is the orbit error, or the clock error, because every receiver assumes a location of the satellite and using this for the computations. So if anything wrong with this, that will cause an error in the actual computation of the GPS location. Also, we have ionospheric delay due to the electrons in the ionosphere. In the atmosphere, and also we can have tropospheric delay, which can come from clouds or humidity or anything in the weather. We have a multi-path problem, which happening from reflection over tall buildings, or from, or can get signal masking from trees, or can get jamming even from other towers or providing signals. US is usually frequently used in mobile robots for estimation of position, but usually used in conjunction with other sensors. Because the update rate of the GPS is relatively slow compared to the other sensors, which is between 1 and 2 hertz, 10 hertz, this gap is filled by higher update rate sensor like IMU, for example. And this combined together in a technique called sensor fusion, which decrease the overall navigation error and add advantage more than using one sensor. So about the IMU inertial measurement unit, it is just an electronic device that uses the linear velocity and angular acceleration of an orientation. The IMU consists of accelerometer, gyroscope, and sometimes a magnetometer. Basically, there is a device called IMS, which is combining an IMU with a GPS to help the position drift that happened by the IMU and the lower update rate that happened by the GPS. However, it requires update from the GPS every now and then. It only can help for some time during tunnels or inside buildings. But because of the drift error of the IMU, it needs to be updated every now and then. For the region-based navigation, it is relatively a new field that is receiving a lot of attention now. Because of the processing power is increased, and it is making it more appealing to researchers. It is more tolerant to error propagation because it is localized error, so it doesn't drift over time. However, it has some challenges, which are the processing speed required for image processing, feature detection, because the image is 2D information, it has maybe sometimes 3D information, it requires a lot of processing compared to the IMU or the GPS, which is 1D information. Also, we have the scale ambiguity, which, because we are taking images of a 3D scene, that's 2D information, so we don't have any depth information, so we can't extract only from the 2D image. Also, the image might get corrupted by noise due to the sensors or vibration or any other parameters. The electric power consumption required for image processing is extensive, so it should make it a little harder to implement on mobile robots because it's a limited battery or limited power there, so you need to be conservative. So the vision based algorithm mainly based on something called the apolar constraint, which is a relation between two images taken at time t and time t plus delta t for the same point, which says that this relation has satisfied in the rotation and translation between each image has satisfied this condition. However, in real life, you can't really get this zeros because due to the vibration and noise of the image. So basically, you're trying to estimate it to get very low zeros. So in order to solve this, to estimate this, we use an 8-point algorithm. It's called 8-point because it requires at least 8 points to estimate solve the equations we have here. We have 9 parameters, which one of them is trivial, so we need at least 8 points to solve, to be able to solve C. And by solving C, which is basically a combination of the relation of each pixel reading in each image, by solving C, we can estimate E, because now we have E, which is the essential matrix. We can use it to extract the rotation and translation. To extract the rotation and translation, we use the SVD of the essential matrix. And basically, the rotation, we have a four solution out of E, which will be R1, which is rotation 1, and rotation 2, will be UWVT, V transpose, and U T transpose, V transpose, which W is basically this matrix, and the translation is either minus or plus U3. U3 is basically the last column of the matrix U. So this way we have four solutions. Basically, only one of them is visible. The way we get which one is visible by projecting the feature points using each pair of this. The four solution, each of the four solution, and only one of them will give us positive depth value. Because any other, if it is giving a negative depth value, that means the feature point is behind the camera, which is not physically possible. That's why the solution won't be visible. So only one of them will provide positive value. However, in real life, not all of them will be providing positive value. So the way it is implemented, taking the majority. This is the best solution that gives the majority of positive depth value. So combining the IMU and the vision together, we came up with a vision-aided sensor fusion algorithm, which utilizing extended camera filter, divided into steps. We have a propagation steps, which using the IMU data for the propagation model, instead of using a regular analytic model, which make it more accurate. And we have the vision-based measurement update, which using the vision-based algorithm to estimate the state vector. The state vector we have here, we have d theta and d phi. We are not estimating the whole total angle, we are only estimating the difference between each frame or each reading. So this way we don't have to worry about error propagation because only estimating the difference. So when we combine it with the vision, we don't have to worry about the accumulated error in the total value. So for the propagation step, we form a rotation matrix, current rotation matrix using the reading from the IMU. So we get also, we can estimate, we convert the acceleration in the reference frame to the world frame using the rotation matrix. Then we integrate the acceleration to get the velocity, and then we integrate the velocity to get the position. for the actual trajectory. It's not part of the filter, but is estimated as part of the computations. However, to estimate to propagate the state, we use the range gyros, which is just a gyro reading multiplied by delta t, which is the time difference between the current reading and the previous reading. And then we update the propagate the error covariance using this equation. A is basically an identity matrix. As you can see here, there is no relation between the state vectors, so A will be our identity matrix. And the propagation vector will be the combination of the three values. For the region update step, we do two things. First, we estimate the scale, or we get the scale from the IMU using the velocity magnitude multiplied by delta t, which we use this scale to multiply by translation extracted from the region here, from frame to frame. And this way, we can solve the scale issue from the region. And also, we have the rotation, which is extracted from the vision frame to frame. And we evolved this in the homogeneous coordinates, RT, which is 4x4 matrix, homogeneous coordinates, which the our three corner would be the rotation, and the vector of three rows would be the translation, and then at the bottom would be the use. And we extract the deltas for our measurement vector using the R by extracting the dxi, dphi, and dtheta from R using the equation. And then we form the measurement vector. So the measurement on this step completes by the Kalman gain update using the error covariance and the measurement matrix, which is basically the identity matrix. And Rm is the measurement points. Then the estimated value is computed using the vectors we extracted from before for the propagation and the measurement using the Kalman gain. And then we update the error covariance using the Kalman gain, the new Kalman gain. Q and R is the burst and rotation, burst and measurement noise, which are tuned to give more weight to the measurement, which is the vision output over the IMU output. So the result. First, we did two experiments on two vehicles. One of them is a quadcopter data set, which using this quadcopter here. Right here, that's the Cherson CX-20. Has the phone mount down there, with the vibration thing to hold the phone. And the sensors was used from a HTC-1 phone, just on the quadcopter. It has a camera, high-resolution camera. It has IMU, GPS, magnetometer with these parameters. This parameter is not available directly online. I have to download that on the phone to actually acquire this parameters. There's no data sheet for it. But the HTC one was pretty powerful, basically, because it has 2 GB RAM, it has quad-core processor, so that's more than enough. The second experiment was done on a computer vision dataset available online, which called KT dataset. It is mainly used for evaluation for this kind of algorithm, navigation algorithm. So it has a lot of, like, many datasets for using standard station wagon, which has the two color camera and two grayscale cameras on top of it. And it has also IMU data provided. It has a real-time laser scanner and GPS to provide the ground truth. First, we started by developing an IMU-based navigation without any other sensors. And we can see is IDU, and we is gonna start left over time and even run more, we're gonna completely go out of the
tech.
What was the timeline on that flight? How long did it take to go from 0-0 to the endpoint there?
That was 30 seconds. I was gonna
okay.
Yeah, more than that. So for the vision base, three methods were implemented to for navigation. We passed surf and Harris corner vector to determine which one is best. Surf provided the best results and for both data sets. Fast provided relatively good results in the KT data set, but not as good as the surf for the quadcopter. And that's because the fast is, as we discussed before, is not very tolerant to scale, which has more like error. So that's for the surf result for the quadcopter. So in comparison with the IMU here, we have the red one is a vision, which you can see it is much more following the GPS. And also for the old vector, we can see it is doesn't drift much over time as the IMU. For the fast result, that was output. While it was good enough for the quadcopter, it started to drift over time. And also provide very similar result in the angular motion, which we expected it because the vision basically usually the angular motion estimation is usually good. For the KT data set, we can see clearly here the problem with the scale. We have like the IMU is drifting, so it doesn't follow the exact shape of the GPS. However, the vision is following the shape, but it is different scale, which because of the scale ambiguity issue, because we're only getting unit vector from the IMU from the vision, and that's for the result. For the fast, we can it is not very visible, but we can see that. Can see the difference is the vision is more closely to the GPS more than the fast. The fast is getting far faster. For the Harris, it is provided a very similar result to fast anyway. So for the vision weight also we add a couple of things. We add a safeguard to detect if the motion was very little or no motion is happening, which using the distance between each pair detect features or track feature. And if this distance is very small, that means there is very little motion. So in this case, I just usually skip the frame and assume the position didn't change. Go to the next frame and try to extract more features. If I have enough features to provide for the fundamental matrix estimator, I go for it. If not, I just skip the next frame and so on. Also, this filter removes a feature that was tracked near the image vanishing point, which usually not very old attack anyway. So that's a good thing to remove it as well before provides these features to the fundamental matrix estimator. So that's the filter that's happening here. So After before filtering, we have this point here on the right. Like the vehicle is turning in this time, so the most movement is happening in the center, which that's why this part here is left. But the other part was on the right, on the left is got removed, which provide less feature to estimate, which makes the algorithm of the estimation later faster also. So the estimation of the fundamental matrix, as we mentioned earlier, we are using 8-point algorithm. However, using the endpoint algorithm likely in the real world won't work because our provide border approximation, because if you are using all the points you are getting, you won't you will have outliers, you have noisy points, so the estimation will be bad. This way that's why we have two things to do here. First, the endpoint assumes that the image frame has to be normalized. So this is done by using the camera calibration parameters and using the distortion parameter to undistort the image before detecting the features. And also we use random selection algorithms in combination with the endpoint algorithm to estimate. The way it is working, it selects 8-point sets from the points we have and try to estimate the fundamental matrix well. If it is better than the previous fundamental matrix or the best one we have, I replace it. If it is not, I go to the next set and so on. This way I can get the best one, best estimation. And this way, because the outlier points will give more approximation anyway, so it will be removed from the estimation. A sound driver was used for the generated result for both Kitty and the quadcopter asset. That was provided the results you saw, and it was really good results. So for learning more about the asset, the Kitty asset was done using the car, following this path here, and it was 82 seconds with 800 frames, which is 10 hertz. And for the Jerson quadcopter is 35 seconds with 300 frames for this path. It was synchronized with the GPS data, because it was synchronized with the GPS data because the camera rate is 30 frames per second, and the IMU rate is 100 hertz. So it was synchronized by filtering, like by matching the image frame to the nearest reading timestamp for the IMU and discarding in between frames. So here is the result for the vision aid algorithm. So we can see that the black line is following much closer to the GPS. It's still drifting after some time, but however, it's providing much better results than IMU alone or vision alone. Solved the scale issue and it solved the drift error as well. That was done using the SIRF. For the quadcopter, also we can see that to provide better results here than the IMU alone or the vision alone with the black line, and even providing better results in the Z direction as well. For the angle estimation, you will see that the black line is following closely the vision-based algorithm, because as we mentioned before, the heavier weighting was given to the measurement noise over the process noise. So, in conclusion, what we did here, we made a vision aid algorithm using developed for a monocular camera. The sensors fusion was done using EKF, which utilizes IMU data and vision for propagation and vision based information for the measurement. The navigation filter was implemented and evaluated on two type of vehicles, ground vehicle and quadcopter UAV. Solved partially the scale problem from the vision based, and solved also partially the drift error from the IMU based. Because we are using random selection algorithm here, the output of the filter for the same data set, if it's run again, it won't give exactly the same result due to the randomness of the selection. However, it is providing much better result than using a regular endpoint alone. The safeguard was implemented to give a better estimation for the fundamental matrix. And we tested different types of feature detector, SURF, and also the algorithm that listed already in OpenCV, which can be used in any of these platforms. And any questions? Thank you. Say hello.
Well, we shut off the Facebook thing then, and we proceed.